prone to H. pylori infection. Table 2 shows the distribution of H. pylori infection in relation to age. Among our study, we found that prevalence of Helicobacter pylori were more common at the age group of 20 to 34 years old and decrease in the older age. And this may be that H. pylori acquired during childhood and they're remaining for lifetime in the individuals unless eradicated. Table 3 shows the percentage of Helicobacter pylori seropositivity according to the level of education. So according to our study, we found that the H. pylori or prevalence of H. pylori infection were more common in individuals that had high educated when compared to the other levels. Table 4 showed the percentage of Helicobacter pylori according to the level of socioeconomic status, means family outcome levels. And from the result of this table, we found that individuals that participated in this study or the prevalence of Helicobacter pylori were more prevalent in individuals at the low and medial family outcome levels than those in high outcome levels. And this may be that individuals at this level or in the low and medium outcome levels may had inadequate healthy knowledge or poor environment, sanitation, congestion, and a greater proclivity to live in the environment that predisposes to fecal contamination of food and water. Table 5 shows the percentage of gastric symptoms in Helicobacter pylori seropositivity. So we found that there's association between the gastric symptoms and H. pylori infection. And also we found that 88.2% of individuals that infected with H. pylori had gastric symptoms. Table 6 showed the percentage of Helicobacter seropositivity considering in the family to family history. So we found that out of the 100 participants, 34 which had H. pylori, 70.6 of them had family history of infection with this bacteria. The last table showed the percentage of H. pylori seropositivity in concern to the type of smoking. Type of smoking means if the smoker smoked nargila or cigarettes. So from the result of this table, we found, although there is no significant between the type of smoking, but we found that 50% of patients which infected with H. pylori were nargila smoking. So from this result, we indicated and approved that H. pylori infection can spread from one person to another person by the saliva of smoker. So in conclusion, we concluded that smoking was a major risk factor in the seroprevalence of Helicobacter and it had suicidal influence on the seroprevalence of Helicobacter pylori, and this may be due to hygienic habitats involved in transmission of bacteria through the saliva of smoker. Regarding to the level of education, socioeconomic status, and family history, all these factors increase the chance of transmission due to the improper hygiene and health care. Also, age show a significant effect on the probability of infection manifesting in young and middle age group than older age. So at the end, prevalence of Helicobacter pylori shows significant value in nargila smoking patients, and this approved that transmission of Helicobacter pylori infection were by spread from person to person by oral route. And so much for, thank you so much for your listening. Thank you.
So Mustafa will present the next speaker.
Dear, don't forget to scan the QR code for the assessment of the research. Our next speaker will be Dr. Mohammed Al-Nu'aymi. The research will be about recovery of COVID-19 patient with complicated diabetic lung abscess in hypertensive and smoker old man from Najran in KSA.
In fact, before I start my talk, I have to say that I have been involved in teaching for the last 25 years in various private universities. 10 years in Jordan, 8 years in Sudan, 7 years in Saudi Arabia. I haven't seen any of these private universities done such I haven't seen any of these universities which I have done work in them done such a successful meeting like this meeting, which in fact reflect the generosity of the honors and the Dean of Jinan University. My talk is about my 6 papers concerning COVID-19 disease. Diabetes mellitus increased dramatically globally. You can see that, for example, in 1980, there was about 100 million. In 2018, about 500 million. And also, there is a frightening increase in diabetes mellitus in Saudi Arabia. Also, we can see about 2.53% in 1980s, up to 25% in 2020. And you can see how it's escalating the rate of prevalence of diabetes mellitus in Saudi Arabia. Our case from Najran city, the south province of Saudi Arabia. Very low prevalence of COVID in Saudi Arabia. In fact, there was a good restriction of the rules preventing the disease in addition to the vaccination. More than 80% of the population in Saudi Arabia is vaccinated. Yeah, I'll just say it again, Dr. Our case is a male, Saudi male, 52 years old, presented with a tightness in the chest, productive cough, and about a week ago he has this clinical features. Admitted to the hospital in the emergency department first and then in isolation room. Examination showed that he has some fine and coarse crepitation in the right lower side of the chest. Chest x-ray shows that he has consolidation in the right lower side of the chest with obliteration of costophrenic angle with a mild pleural fluid in the right lower part of the chest. CT scan demonstrated a multilobulated fluid collection mainly in the right side of the right lower side of the chest, which gives the diagnosis of lung abscess. Of course, hematological examination has been done, increased ESR, increased C-reactive protein, leukocytosis, mainly neutrophils, was high, about 87%, with a low lymphocyte, which is about 10%. And this reflects the viral activity against the immunity. This patient, for the last 20 years, he has diabetes mellitus, and he is under treatment. And for the last 10 years, he has hypertension, and he's on antihypertensive drugs as well. And he's a heavy smoker. So admitted to the hospital, and is given anti-COVID treatment for 10 days, combination of anti-COVID treatment, and antibacterial for the lung abscess for 5 weeks. And recovered, although we know that even a single one of these severe, serious disease like diabetes or hypertension or an old case, more than 52, or lung abscess, increase the rate of admission and mortality of COVID patient. And this patient has all these serious conditions. But thanks for goodness, he recovered successfully and went home about 4 weeks after admission. And we followed the patient after a month and 2 months. The advantage is he has cessation of smoking and recovered all the clinical features which has been admitted for. In conclusion, it's okay. We can say that this is the first case of a lung abscess complicating diabetes mellitus in Saudi Arabia. And it's the first case of a recovered COVID patient with these severe illness. There are only two reports, French report, about lung abscess complicating COVID, and one Iranian report also. All of them are 2022, a couple of weeks ago. Also, a lung abscess complicating COVID. But this case is a concomitant lung abscess with COVID. It's not a complication of COVID. So we have a good recovery of this patient. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much,
Dr. Thank you, Dr. Mohammed, for the interesting presentation. QR code for Dr. Muhammad's speech. So if you have, can see some cameras there, so that's good. Give your evaluation form, please, and submit it to the conference committee. The next presentation, Identification of Biofilm Procedures, Staphylococcus aureus, by Dr. Sirwan Rashid, and Sausan Muhammad, and other people. So welcome to the stage.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Assistant Lecturer Sirwan Ahmed, working as Assistant Lecturer at Jihan University. For me, it's the first year as an academic experience at the university. In my career, I already started my career the previous year. Today, I would like to share with you, it's my pleasure to share with you a part of a larger work and larger study. So I took some parameters with some, let's say, data that I would like to share with you for our review and our study for today, which is about identification biofilm producers Staphylococcus aureus isolates and detect their biofilm genes from gingivitis cases. So before I start with you, why it's important subject, I would try to make a note on it, the gingivitis. Gingivitis is considered one of the, let's say, very common and almost most of the people, especially I'm saying that for our region, our country, they can have these kind of issues with gingivitis. So that's why I would like to just make a note for this thing. At the beginning, we will make introduction, then we will go to the aims of the study, then with the materials and method, result, and finally with conclusion. Then about the introduction about biofilm, especially biofilm of dental plug. What we mean by biofilm of dental plug is an area where, especially within the gum and gingiva, where you have accumulation of, let's say, a mixture of bacterial with extracellular substances together, which will lead to have all of these kind of microorganisms with bacteria surrounding the gum within the gingiva, saliva, and bacterial products. The left untreated biofilm can inflame the gums, leading to the gingivitis, which is our topic for today. With the accumulation for all of these, let's say, together, it will lead for gingivitis. And of course, if you don't have a treatment for it, if you leave it as itself, it can lead for more severe case as a periodontitis. As you can see here, maybe it's not too clear on the data show. Let me see, this picture is more clear. You have swelling and redness for the gingiva within the, let's say, the base of the teeth, whereas as a result of these accumulation of microorganism and bacterial product and all of these stuff. So we will see how can many microorganisms together and some common bacteria can lead for these results. We have Staphylococcus aureus bacteria, which is one of the specimen or the one of the isolates that I took and make this study for this conference, which is the Staphylococcus aureus, a gram-positive round-shaded bacteria. In the oral tract, you can have Staphylococcus aureus can be associated with dentoalveolar infection, oral mucosal colonization, and demonstrated also from tongue, mucosal surface, and supergingival tooth, which is my sample or my specimen were from the supragingival teeth unplugged. Aims, why we did this study and why we can, let's say, consider it one of the important, let's say, study that we need to have in our region and country isolation and identification of Staphylococcus aureus from the gingivitis cases in Erbil City. Then we need to identify and make sure these isolate are Staph aureus by using the VITIC 2 machine or technique. Determine the ability of Staph aureus to make a biofilm. I made a test to determine the ability to have producing the biofilm using the Congo red agar. Of course, there's many other methods. I did also. One of them is Congo red agar that I will share with you today. At the end, using the PCR polymerase chain reaction, I did the gene detection for these genes, which is responsible for the biofilm genes, and make the genes are, appear. Experimental work. For this study, I took 50 specimens or 50 samples from the Erbil Dysentery College of Medicine. From their lab, from 50 patients, I took the sample, then sent it to the laboratory using VITIC 2 to make the identification for these isolate to know which bacteria we can have. And the duration, 2018, November to February 2019. The identification done by using the VITIC 2 technique machine, of course, after I had a pure culture and using the gram positive ID card to detect and identify my specimen and samples. Then I went for the process of determination the ability to produce biofilm by the using the method Congo red agar, which if I have a positive result, it should have a black colony. If it's, biofilm negative, producer should be a red color colony. At the end, I went for the last part in the study, which is about detection the genes, which is responsible for those or these biofilm genes, which is ECA, DC, FINBA, and PNA. Of course, according to references, I choose these genes. Then, from these 50 samples I had, and I studied from male and female, I had 22 male patients and 28 female patients from these 50. And from all patients, there were only 11, which is about 22%, Staphylococcus aureus isolates. From all the 50 patients, I got only 11 isolates for Staph aureus. Of course, I had many other isolate bacteria and did many other studies, but I'm focusing on this study today only on Staph aureus. So, as you can see from the table, 50 sample, I got 11 isolate for Staph aureus bacteria. Then the next part was to trying to see the ability or the power to have the biofilm producing from these isolate of Staphylococcus aureus. As you can see from the picture, if I have a positive result for biofilm producing using the Congo red agar, I should have a black colony. If I have it as a negative, I will have a colony, but it's not clear, maybe in the picture, which is a negative biofilm producer. So I found that from these 11 isolates I got as Staph aureus, it's about almost all of them, which is 10, make the 90.9% Staph aureus were biofilm positive, and only one isolate I had as a negative biofilm procedure, as you can see. Moving to the next part, which is about the detection, the biofilm genes, I try to check whether I have these biofilm genes within the samples and the isolate I have got from these 11 to detect these four genes, ECA, CD, FINBA, and CNA. I found that for the ECA, C, from the 11 isolate, I have 11 of them positive, which is 100% positive detection for the EKC. Moving to the EKD, it was also the same result. All 11 isolate, I got them having the gene EKD. FINBA, also the same. From 11 isolate, I got all of the 11 isolate having the FINBA biofilm gene. At the end, for the last one, CNA biofilm gene, I got only 10 biofilm gene producer on the PCR, which is 90.9%, and only one negative result, or which is I don't have the band for it. As you can see the pictures, this one for the ECASI, for the all 11 isolate using the PCR and on the gel electrophoresis, 209 base pair. All 11 isolate show that they have the band for the ECASI. Moving for the ECAD, also the same result, 11 bands, which represent a positive result. Of course, the band should be within the range 198 base pair. Moving to the FinBA biofilm gene, which is about 191 exactly base pair. Also, all 11 bands show that we have the result, but only the CNA biofilm gene show that I have only 10 band or 10 positive band, which is represent about 716 base pair according to the references, which showed me a positive result, and only one of them was negative result, and we didn't have a band. And as a conclusion, from these 50 patients or 50 sample I got at the lab, most of the patient or most of the sample were female recorded. Most of isolates show that all of them, or not all of them, almost of all of them have a positive biofilm ability or producer using the Congo red agar method, of course, we don't forget that. And for the four biofilm genes, we detect through amplification PCR, ECASI-D, and CNA, and FinBA have these genes. Only one sample, which was the CNA, only one specimen or one Staph aureus isolate did not, let's say, show a band. Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
QR code scanning. Our next speaker will be Dr. Suhaila H. Sharif. The research will be antimicrobial activity of Caesium aromaticum and Salvadora persica against dental plaque pathogens.
Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Suhaila. I presented my paper entitled Antimicrobial Activity of the Caesium aromaticum clovis and Salvadora persica miswag against dental plaques pathogens. We know dental plaque of microorganisms, the growth of the bacteria on the surface of the tooth, lead to the significant contributor to the development and onset growth of the bacteria on the surface of the tooth. Due to the results of the growth of these bacteria on the surface of the tooth, of the oral disorders, such as dental caries and the periodontal diseases. We can control plaque accumulation by using natural herbal products, which lead to the for the optimal oral health and the oral hygiene. Plant provides significant bactericidal actions against these oral hygiene microorganisms, and in comparison to the standard drugs, the scientific effect of the drugs become fewer of the plants against of the standard drugs. Salvadora Persica, Miss Wak, was advised as a sunnah by the Prophet Muhammad, is a miswak for the oral hygiene. Salvadora Persica from the family of the Salvadoracea family, which is, it is used as a chewing stick. Chewing stick are the toothpastes for the oral hygiene. Miswak has been utilized as a numerous for a stick, extracted powders and toothpastes for the powerful effect against the bactericidal effect present in the oral hygiene. The presence, because miswak contain a powerful content named benzyl isocyanate present in the miswak, which acts as a powerful substance against antibacterial or bactericidal effect, and the antifungals and antiviral in the oral environment. Sigigram aromaticum cloves against the dental plaques. Sigigram aromatic from the gloves is cloves is from the family Metasia family, used as a spice all over the world. There, because contain these cloves oils, their oil is powerful against the bactericidal effect. Also present to relieve toothaches. Toothaches are recommended by the dentist. Gloves bath oil also powerful antibacterial against microorganism and the dental plaque produced around or on the surface of the tooth. The objective of my paper is that the study focuses on the antimicrobial activity of the Salvadora Persica and the Sigigram aromaticum, these two herbal products extracted against the dental plaque. Material and methods, we are used media, blood agars, Mukogi agars, and the TSF nutrient broth for the growth of the other bacterial suspension. And the Muller-Henton agar was used for the sensitivity tests. The isolated microorganism is recommended and produce a colony morphology by using the AP20 and the Epistat. The methods of my study, we are collected the dental plaque swabs from the 35 patients in the Khanzat Hospital in Erbil City. We are used these medias and the identification of the Actinobacillus, Actinomycetes done according to the colony morphology, because this colony have the star shape in the center of the colonies. The preparation of the Salvadora Persica miswak, how we are prepared these powers of the powders of these extracts, miswaks. We are broken by the automatic blenders and grounded into power in a bowl mill to make aqueous extract. After that, we are taken from these extracted 10 grams from these powders, mixed with the 100 distilled water, and they are centrifuged and saved on the filter papers. We are taken 50% of the Salvadora Persica for our tests. Preparation of the microorganism, the density of the 3 or 4 colonies of microorganisms were suspended in nutrient agar for growing of the bacteria. And to take 0.5 antimicrobial assays of the Salvadora Persica, filter paper we are used, this filter paper diameter of the 5 millimeters were prepared and sterilized using 95% of the ethanol. Results of the our study, patient's age and gender distribution, the 35.3% females located at the age group 50 and 59, while regarding to the male, 50% of the male located in the group age 60 and 69. Regarding to the distribution, tooth brushing daily in relation to the gender, 72.7% females daily brushing our teeth. Regarding males,
38.5% daily toothbrushing. The table 3 shows that the antimicrobial activity of the Salvadora persica and the Cygium aromaticum extract on isolated bacteria and pro and the zoon inhibition regarding to the according to these herbal products, we are found that the Salvadora persica zoon inhibition larger when we are compared to the zoon inhibition of the Cygium aromaticum. Our study concluded that the Cygium aromaticum and Salvadora persica have antibacterial efficacy and their combination has shown a greater effect. Clove is also known to relieve the pain for the tooth when used to treat toothache because of it is antiseptic and disrupted the cytoplasmic membrane of the bacteria. We concluded that these herbal alternatives have fewer side effects when we compared with the standard drug. Thank you for listening. بس وقتها كان عندكم هذا مو زال الكتب ده
يا Dr. Sarwan Bradowski and Ahmed Megari about African trypanosomiasis. Are they here in the room? No? Okay. The next speaker after that will be the role of NRF2 activator by Dr. Najah Hadi, Saif Hassan, and Basim Muhammad. Dr. Najah, thank you.
Good morning, dear colleagues. I am pleased to be here with you to present my work entitled Role of NRF2 Activators in Amelioration of Cerebral Ischemia Reperfusion Injury and Experimental Study. Ischemia reperfusion is widely met in clinical practice. It means it is due to cessation of blood supply to an organ, then after that reperfusion. The cessation of blood supply will cause inadequate blood, oxygen, and nutrient to the tissues. And this will activate, or the result will be oxidative stress and activation of inflammatory cascade in the organ. Upregulation in the intracellular redox status will affect cellular gene expression of inflammatory pathways, activation of toll receptor or increased toll receptor expression, and the resultant will be activation of a nuclear kappa phi and MAP kinase pathways. NRF2 is a master regulator of oxidative stress. It regulates basal and stress-inducible expression of gene components of the antioxidant system. The antioxidant system include glutathione transferase, hemoxygenase 1, superoxide dismutase, and catalase. Hypothesis, we hypothesize that bardinoxolone methyl and dimethyl fumarate have a neuroprotective effect via down regulation of TOR receptor expression and activation of NRF2 transcription. Aim of the study is to study the possible neuroprotective effect of these drugs alone and in combination for attenuation of cerebral ischemia reperfusion injury. These drugs are called NRF2 activator, DMF, dimethyl fumarate, is licensed for use in psoriasis and in multiple sclerosis. Bardinoxolone methyl, there are many studies that find that is effective in chronic kidney disease and other inflammatory pathways, and not yet approved for clinical use. The study included 36 rats divided into equal groups, into sham group, in which there is no occlusion of the bilateral common carotid arteries, while the control group occlusion of the common carotid arteries for half an hour, followed by reperfusion for 1 hour. No drug was given to this group. Vehicle group as the control, but received the vehicle component for the drugs, which is DSMO, intraperitoneally 24 hours before ischemia. Treatment groups include bardinoxolone group as the control, but received bardinoxolone at 3 mg/kg intraperitoneally 24 hours before ischemia. DMF group received DMF 50 mg/kg IP 24 hours before ischemia, and the combination of the two drugs also given IP 24 hours before ischemia. This is a schematic representation for the study. We measured NRF2 cytoplasmic component and the nuclear component. Also, we measured by immunohistochemistry TOL4 expression in the brain tissue. Also, histopathology, we studied the damage score in the brain. Also, there's measurement of malondialdehyde for oxidative stress, measurement of a nuclear factor kappa P and interleukin-6. Results. The study showed that pre-treatment with bardinoxolone and DMF 24 hours before induction of ischemia caused significant reduction in the cytoplasmic NRF2. And the result is more significant when we use both drugs in combination. It is significantly better than either drug alone. At the same time, these drugs increase the nuclear level of NRF2 in brain tissue. Both drugs, bardinoxolone and DMF, caused significant increase in nuclear NRF2, which is significantly higher in the combination group. MDA level, which is the end product of oxidative stress, is significantly reduced in brain tissue in both treatment groups and in the combination group. Concerning histopathology, treatment with these drugs caused significant amelioration of cerebral ischemia, as evidenced by less damage score. We can see here in the bardinoxolone group and DMF group, the damage score is significantly less than control group and DMSO group, and the combination is better than either drug alone. TOL4 expression is significantly reduced in both drug treatment groups and significantly more in the combination group. This is the histopathology. This is showing edema, hemorrhage, necrosis in different parts of the brain. In bardinoxolone group, it's a sample slide showing mild edema, while in the control group, there is severe edema. In the DMF group, mild edema, and combination group, almost near normal. We can conclude from our study that bardinoxolone DMF and DMF have a neuroprotective effect against cerebral ischemia reperfusion injury, which is manifested as anti-inflammatory effect. It decreases nuclear factor kappa B, decreases interleukin-6 significantly in brain tissue. And the combination of these drugs caused more amelioration of inflammation and oxidative stress in the brain tissue. Thank you for listening. I am ready to receive your questions, if any question.
QR code scanning. The last research of our session will be presented by Dr. Noor Sami Omar, talking about difference among intensity modulated radiation therapy and 3D conformal radiation therapy plans for patients with brain cancer.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much to have been here. So as mentioned, if you see the title, it is about the radiotherapy. So basically the research was about the differences among the intensity modulated radiation therapy and 3D conformal radiotherapy with patients with brain cancer. So you know that because brain cancer is so much spread around the world, not just brain cancer, actually most of the types of cancer, but for our research, we will just focus on the brain cancer. So we have different types of technique and also different, let's say, part or let's say treatment to treat the brain, like surgery, like chemotherapy, and also radiation therapy. So now we will focus on radiation therapy, which is radiotherapy. Basically, it's for treating the different type of cancer, as I said. But the main point is, how can we make it easier? Because we have different types of techniques. So we have basically 3D, three-dimensional conformal radiotherapy, and also IMRT, or let's say intensity modulated radiotherapy. For 3D CRT, or three-dimensional conformal radiation therapy, it is basically we use 3 to 4 fields. This field actually, it will cover the PTV in order to, let's say, cover all the treatment, the tumor. Then the second type we have, and this is, by the way, the, picture that we can see all the tumor, and then, of course, we will give many fields in order to cover all the tumor. Then we have the IMRT, or intensity modulated radiation therapy. This is somehow, more advanced than 3D CRT. And basically, very simply, we can say it will cover more and also protect the organ at risk as much as possible. Now, this is actually the LINAC, or the device that we used for both plans, the 3D CRT and also IMRT. So our research, or our study, it was done in General Cancer Center in Slovenia. And we chose 8 cases, 7 with brain cancer, 1 with chordoma. And it was, in duration from November 2018 till 2019. And actually, we plan for both study with the IMRT and also 3D CRT to see which treatment or, which technique is better to treat the brain cancer. So this is also inversely, or we can say, intensity modulated radiotherapy is like inverse. So first it will protect the organ at risk and then it will try or start to cover the PTV. So our result actually, we choose different doses. So with the first one, we choose 40 gray. So the result was actually homogeneity index and conformity index, it was similar for both plants. So there wasn't any differences. For the dose 98 also it was somehow similar. Actually for the first one we have for right and left eye, IMRT was better to cover the organat risk than 3D-CRT. And for, sorry, it's not written, but because it's a PDF. So second one is cochlea. Also, IMRT was better for 3D-CRT for right and left cochlea. Third one, we have optic nerve. Also for, here we have lenses. So we see that the technique of IMRT was, let's say, 3D-CRT was better than IMRT because it received less dose than IMRT. And here's also for optic nerve as well, we can see IMRT was better than 3D-CRT. That was for, let's say, four patients which already include, let's say, for T gray. What about therapy gray, which include two patients? So that was the result. The homogeneity index and also conformity index was similar for both plan, which we can say there wasn't a very big differences. And for organat risk, again, for eye, actually white and left eye, for 3D-CRT was better than IMRT for the white, but for the left, IMRT was better than 3D-CRT. This is regarding the eye. And also with cochlea, we can see that, again, the white, both, let's say, for the white cochlea, 3D-CRT was better than IMRT, but for the left, we can see IMRT was better than 3D-CRT. So basically, this is the important point that we can see what is the differences or which one is better to first protect the organat risk and also to, let's say, cover the PTF, or let's say the tuber. And also here we can see for the lens as well, 3D-CRT were better than IMRT. Here also we can see the optic nerves actually for 3D-CRT. Let's say it was somehow similar for both plans. For dosimetric 39, which include one patient, we can see most of the organat risk from 3D-CRT and also IMRT somehow were similar. Some of the treatment for 3D-CRT, let's say, it received less, and sometimes for IMRT. So for last one is patients, which include, again, one patient with 60 gray receiving the radiation, and that was the, let's say, the result. So all the organat risk, again, for both, let's say, technique were somehow similar. Some organat risk for 3D-CRT were better, and some of them were better from IMRT. Now, regarding the discussion, of course, you know that most of the, let's say, study they already did before. Many, let's say, in many different countries, they did this study, which compared between IMRT and 3D-CRT. So actually, we compare our result with many study which already done. For example, with Al-Zayat in 2014, we can see the result was similar with us, which the PTV was covered by IMRT was better than 3D-CRT. And also another study, it was already done in 2013 and also another one in 2017, which all of them, they confirm, or let's say the result was similar with our result, which most of the time IMRT was better than 3D-CRT. In conclusion, actually, we can say that both technique, it's good to using to treat brain cancer, but if the PTV was so much close to organat risk, I guess, and depending on our research, it's better if we use IMRT. But if the organat risk were somehow far away from the tumor, we can use 3D-CRT. But regarding, or let's say, depending on our research, IMRT were so much better than 3D-CRT to cover more the PTV and also to, let's say, protect the organat risk as much as possible. And that was actually conclusion, and thank you. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for attending. scientifically intense and a morning of interesting presentations from all over the world. Thank you for attending the morning session of the conference. And now we have a little bit of time for some questions and answers. So if you have any questions, if our speakers could come to the podium or be ready for questions. Any questions on the, yeah, Dr. Falah. And if the speakers want to come to the podium, feel free. Serwan, anyone? Yeah. Dr. Falah, you have a question about the radiotherapy.
Did you get the question?
Again. What was your question?
Proton therapy in the near future is replacing radiotherapy. Your comments about that. Thank you.
That's so much right. Actually, proton therapy is so much, let's say, advised than, or let's say, more what's called very better than 3DCRT or even IMRT or even VMAT. But the point is, because it's so much expensive and it's not exist in everywhere. So maybe in USA it exists and some type, let's say some countries, but not all. So basically in Iraq we don't have photon. Instead of that, in Erbil or even Soleimani or even Baghdad, we have the photon therapy, or let's say radiotherapy. Photon also, it is radiotherapy, because at the end it is radiation. So if we have photon, if we have proton, if we have sometimes neutron, it's the same radiation. The point is, because let's say 3DCRT or IMRT, or as in general, these, let's say, devices is somehow cheaper than proton. That's why already we use it, and it's good. But more than that, let's say more advanced than that, of course, the proton and neutron as well. Actually, we cannot say which one, because all of them, they have the side effect, which means that all of them, because we have the tumor and surround the tumor is normal tissue, which it will be affected. But instead of that, we can see which one it will protect the organ at risk more. So as much as it was more advanced, 100% it will protect more. For example, two-dimension, it will not protect. Three-dimension protect, IMRT protect more. VMAT protect more than that. Proton protect more than that, because it will accurate, like it will contour the tumor and just give the radiation to the tumor. So it depends on the technique. Thank you. Another question?
Any other questions for any of the speakers from this morning? Feel free. Firas? You lost the track of the question, okay. yeah, Shakir.
Yes.
My question is, Prof. Christoph, is what are the criteria or parameters that you used as anticipation for a pandemic? In the past, for the COVID, maybe in the future, I don't know which is the pandemic is coming. So again, my question is, what criteria or parameters that you used?
But you're asking about the pandemic itself, right?
Yeah.
So the general definition is that it's an occurrence more frequent than usual in the certain period of time. So actually there was a lot of discussion about the criteria when you see a pandemic and whether mortality means something to determine a pandemic. And that's very fluid, I have to be honest, because like in 2009 we had a worldwide pandemic of influenza H1, and that was indeed a pandemic, but with a very, very low mortality. Then we had SARS-CoV-2, which had an IFR of about 1 to 2%, and this also was a pandemic. So I would say that there are definitions by WHO, there are definitions by CDC, and there are definitions by ECDC. But I cannot give you clear numbers what it means that there is a pandemic. I would say that the moment that you have the new disease or the old disease that is occurring with rate that is significantly higher than in previous years, and that's in more than three regions, more than two regions of the WHO regions, so that occurs, then you're talking about the pandemic, and that's the general rule for to follow. But how many cases more than in previous year is a pandemic, that will depend also on mortality, that will also depend on long-term consequences, and I cannot give you the exact numbers here.
I'm not looking for the number, but I'm looking how you anticipate, how can you foretell a pandemic is coming? Yes.
But how can you tell that at this moment we have a pandemic, right?
Yes, it's coming, a coming pandemic or upcoming.
Oh, so how can you say that it will be a pandemic? So, yes. Well, that depends on the transmissibility. That would depend on R factor, transmissibility, and also local spread. So I think that SARS-CoV-2 was a beautiful example of how it happens. We did see in China that there was a rapid spread with R factor much higher than we did see for other diseases. It was local, so we called it an outbreak. Then it spread it further, and then once we did see that it was not contained in mainland China, then the decision was made to prepare for the pandemic, because the parameters of the virus, so that is mortality plus the morbidity plus the transmissibility, and the whole world that is naive to the infection, and then it was prepared for the pandemic, because already then it was known. So I would say it's a combination of factors and the epidemiological observation. I don't think you can say that just looking in the lab on the virus, but it's always, that's the same with the variants. So for the variants now, for SARS-CoV-2, we have a group by the European Commission. And we are looking at the variants to determine what is the variant of concern for coming months. And it's always like the basis for that is the lab work, so looking how well the virus is being neutralized by the antibodies generated against previous variants of vaccines. We look at the transmissibility, but it always has to be backed up by the epidemiological observation from your world. So first it's always an outbreak, and then you can speculate further.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Another question, Christoph, I think.
Thank you for the valuable presentation. Are you familiar with the chloroquine? As in limitations, mode of action, probably when and when not to use it.
When to use chloroquine or not.
So about chloroquine, my answer would be pretty short and clear. Don't use it for COVID. It's an artifact. That's what I started my presentation with. The chloroquine, it's the effect in vitro is an artifact that was generated early during the pandemic. It has some anti-inflammatory activity, so you will see some, maybe in the second phase of the disease, some of the effect. But clinical trials, large clinical trials that were carried out showed that the effect is reverse. So if you have a randomized placebo-controlled clinical trial, the patients are actually doing worse on chloroquine than without chloroquine. And this, I have to say, is backed by the scientific proofs. And I had this discussion early in 2020. There was a pharma company who wanted me to join them to implement chloroquine in Poland, and I refused because we already knew that was an artifact, but there was so much pressure, political pressure, and also from the medical society, the medical side pressure, that it was approved, but there is really no argument to use it at this moment. So my answer would be don't.
Was it approved by the TGA?
Sorry?
Was it approved by the TGA? Was it approved by the TGA? Like the FDA?
So it was approved for use in Europe. I don't know about the FDA. I think also FDA approved it for use, but for that I cannot guarantee. For Poland, it was approved as a treatment. Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah. That's a fair answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone here. So if you take a minute just to fill the evaluation form, I guarantee that all of you will pass. So there is no pass or fail, but yes, feel free to fill the evaluation form for the whole conference. Please take pictures of this screenshots. And this is the main thing, so that we can do better in future conferences. We can think and reflect about what did we do well, how we can do better. So just 1 minute maybe to take pictures and give your feedback. You just put your name, your designation, and then rate the conference. So it shouldn't take more than 1 minute, really. يعني بليز تراي تو اخذ صوره للباركود هذا او الكيو ار كود وحطوها بتليفونكم والفيدباك بليز فيل ذا فيدباك فورم ستودنتس تيشرز ادوكيترز ريسيرشرز ايفرون ثانك يو Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Music down. Thank you. So now I'll hand over to Ms. Shada. She'll introduce the next speaker for the workshop. Just a gentle reminder, so please, people who are talking at the back in the background, try to keep the noise level to the minimum. If you want to talk, you try to speak outside the hall. We have important presentations and workshops, and we would like to focus on the speakers. So thank you. Shut up.
Dear guests, it's my pleasure to ask Dr. Arna Chana, Assistant Professor, Project Leader, Intercolonial University in Poland, to present her international workshop about various in vitro modules for diabetes treatment. Thank you.
And where it goes from?
Okay. So, hello everybody. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you to the Chilean University. Today I will talk about the various in vitro models for diabetes treatment. So, let's start. Briefly about me, so I want to introduce myself a little bit. So, currently I'm working at the Jagiellonian University, but before I did my PhD in Germany at Max Planck University. Then I moved to Harvard Medical School to study a little bit of biological systems. I work a little bit behind the Arctic Circle too, so and also in Switzerland, also with models of biological models for disease. I also work in South China University. It was my first kind of adventure in Asia. And coming back to my mother country, I took the position, and I'm now currently leading a small group. So I will talk about diabetes, because diabetes is a global problem. It has been also a problem in Kurdistan. So actually, around 2 million of the Iranians are suffering from the diabetes. And mostly, it is occurring in poor women. So it's the very difficult disease, currently affecting around 500 million of people globally. The numbers are continuously increasing, so it's actually the number of the people with diabetes currently around 500 million may reach about 700 million in 2045. So the prevalence of diabetes by age and gender in 2021 is shown here. And as you see, the male and female population is fluctuating, and females are more affected currently by this disease. Also about the cost, it's very costly disease. So actually around 690 billion euro this disease can cost annually. It's spent on health expenditure. And the numbers also are huge. So therefore, maybe you can now understand how important it is to talk and to try to treat this disease. So about history, the diabetes has been known for a very long time, and it has been tried to be treated by different approaches. So historically, first it was tried to discover something, some kind of agent that could reverse the disease, and the very known insulin was first. Then this progressed, and we recently got into the stage that we have some medicines that can help that. And still the most popular is the transplantation. So what we are trying to do, we try to make more elegant approach and to try to use some medicine that could also improve and then could also maybe increase the healthy cells that can produce the insulin. Today I will talk about models that are important for improving the number of cells which are healthy and which are producing the insulin. So one of the models helping in that is there's a type of proteins that are called kinases, and they belong to specific family, and the kinases are blocking of these kinases is responsible for actually modulation of the growth and proliferation of some of the cells, including diabetes-related beta cells. So some of the proteins like DIRC and GSK3 beta are negatively regulating proliferation of beta cells which are producing insulin. So one of the mechanisms is the ENFAT DIRC1A pathway that's actually responsible for the proliferation. So they are the proteins which are binding together and they are blocking the transcription of some genes which are also responsible for the proliferation and the growth. And previous work showed that inhibition of these proteins may be involved in different regulation of different diseases, including Alzheimer's and neurodegenerative disease. And also some first indication was about involve this the same things in the diabetes. So actually our first work from 2018 shows some inhibitors which are blocking two important agents, and this is DIRG1 and GSK three beta protein. And here is our approach, and the approach actually is divided into three phases. The phases show some models, the phases show the processes, and the phase three shows the future approach, how we try to deal with the disease in our study. So actually first mentioned inhibitors is a common process that you can see in drug discovery. So usually we start with huge pool of inhibitors. In our case, it was around 10 million inhibitors library. And we try to narrow it down to eliminate the unspecific chemical compounds. And we also start with this library. We narrow it down to a few hundred inhibitors, and it was done by computational biology. And as follows, we use a biochemical and structural evaluation of these compounds to study the utility in the process. So here just a representative examples for the assays which we are using. So we are using some assays directly in the cells. We are checking the activity of these inhibitors. We are trying to see how they are localized topologically in the protein by evaluation through the crystal structure. And through the evaluation of the binding and the orientation of the bonds, we are trying to explore the binding pockets and try to optimize the inhibitor. So additionally, we are doing the cellular models, and the cellular models are helping us to see the specificity regarding some particular mechanisms. So in our case, it was the NFAT mechanism, which was kind of leading. But we are also seeking, and we are open to see other mechanisms that can regulate the process. So they are just the examples, because as my title was about the models, so this is how we can do it in lab, how we can approach it. And the anti-diabetic potential of these inhibitors are checked in the insulinoma cells, and these are also, of course, in vitro studies. And we are first trying to detect the target and then to try to see whether the target shows some real involvement in this process by different measures of the factors that are actually responsible for our disease detection. So in this case, we want to see the insulin changes and other hormonal changes in the cells, which can reflect the situation in the body. And as I told you, the most important thing is the proliferation of the beta cells. So the current knowledge shows how to regulate the glucose, but the most important is to improve the performance of the cells which are responsible for the production of the insulin. So the proliferation is a very important factor. And the effect of these inhibitors can be also can be measured through the different studied kind of candidates, and we have here different various numbers of the inhibitors which we study as an example, and we compare it to the golden standards. And this is how we can actually extract the best possible candidates for the future optimization. And we just used different techniques like confocal microscopy. Confocal microscopy, and we do three-dimensional models. And one of them is the organoid, and it's from human iPS stem cells. So these organoids are formed spontaneously or as a 3D, but upon special treatment which allows them to differentiate from very primitive cells to very advanced cell models. And this is the closest model that we can obtain in lab to human situation which we can observe in the human body. So we are detecting the first indication of the formation of the functional cells. And this can be done daily by checking the expression of the differentiation markers. And then when the cell forms the final form of the organoid, it can be used for testing different inhibitors and different factors to see whether the reaction is kind of whether it is visible or not, and whether it's detectable. So it's a very good initial model. We also do, we can also make a functional study on these models, so to directly check whether these structures can behave similarly to the, in our case, in the beta cells from the pancreas. So we can also detect the insulin changes and other hormone changes. So this is the most kind of important model that we can obtain and we can use. And we also isolate the islets directly from the animals. So from mice in our case, and we're isolating the small structures, we are trying to preserve it. And we are also later checking and testing with different inhibitors and different factors. So as you can see here on the bottom, this shows the viability of the structure and size. And on the right bottom, you can also see the insulin secretion bars. So it is also upon particular treatment, we can see the changes in the insulin secretion in this model in comparison to the controls that actually with our compounds show kind of significant change. And as previously saw on the drug discovery slide, we have to narrow down the huge number of the compounds of the candidates to some which are the most promising. And actually here it shows the number of the inhibitors which we are able to check and to see and how it actually happens to be some of them active and some inactive even after this first screen. And our actually aim is not only to optimize these inhibitors but also to find something completely new. So as everybody wants to have the new, completely new drug and functional drug, this is actually also the aim for us. So we would like to get some compound that is unique, that we can say it's done by us directly. And the secondary optimization is very important because it can be very misleading. So we have to immediately check it in the biological systems. In our case, we are able to reach the status when the secondary inhibitors are already active in the biological model. So this shows actually kind of combination of the methods which we are doing to reach the point when we have some knowledge, when we have some progress. And actually this is the part of the puzzle, as mentioned previously, is seeking for the new targets. And in our case, we also found a new target in collaboration that allows us to expand our knowledge. So we can do it through the de novo fishing, and we are fishing it through the inhibitors which are specific. It can be done by the combination of the chemistry and biology. And also the novel targets are found by just by the analysis, mostly mass spec analysis. So the validation of the new target, in this case is a protein called S-POP, can go through the same medicine and chemistry approach. So we already know that there are some inhibitors which are involved in the inhibition of this target, and that they are also, in consequence, are causing some changes in the beta cells. So in our case, again, we are interested in the insulin production, and through this method we are able to find the target interesting for our study. So also this kind of this study follows with the classical biological tests which are performed, and which also can validate the utility of the inhibitor in for the further research. So the basic study can be done pretty easily in the laboratory, in the biochemistry laboratory, combined with the cell biology. But further work requires more advanced models, including like human models, and some further optimization of the compounds that can be more useful for the administration in the living body. So actually, we've been able to obtain several structures with our new inhibitors in the university. It shows kind of robustness of the process. These are the crystal structures with the inhibitors, just like example, just to show how it actually works. And just for summary, so just to go through the process of the modeling of the in vitro models for this, for diabetes, for which we are doing in our lab. So we start from the compounds, we try to optimize the compounds. One of the optimization is also the encapsulation of the compounds. Then we are following by the cell-based assays, such using for this the cell line, classical cell lines, or the isolated cells, or the organoids, to measure, to check the vitals of this organoid-like structure, which can resemble the body situation. Then we are trying to seek for the targets to expand a little bit of the knowledge what we have. So we know that the disease is never regulated by one factor. So we want to try to expand the number of factors and knowledge about them. In our case, since there are kinases, it goes through the signaling pathways. And the final is the in vivo proof of concept study. So actually using the final model that is in our case the animals, so it allows for the most light validation. And actually that's all. I want to just tell about my small group. So they are the members of the group that I worked for last 2 years with them, 2.5 years with, and these people who helped me to reach the point, and including our guests who are here with me from the Agronomia University, and Professor Abdul Karim, who also invited us here for the meeting, and here just meeting the financing and the supports. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you can ask some questions.
Oh, you mean on the back? Oh, this one. any questions for Anna? Any questions, any comments or feedback? So I can't see all the hands. Yes, Dr. Saif, Ubadian, Dr. Anna. Thank you. Microphone? تعال للستيج الأقرب إذا تقدر.
Hi, Doctor. This inhibitor can be inhibit the destruction of beta cell.
Yep.
This inhibitor
yes.
can inhibit the destruction of beta cell.
Construction, actually in this case, it's promoting because we are trying to inhibit the proteins which are responsible for slowing down the proliferation. So when we stop the protein, the proliferation can go because we have the proteins which we identified as a negative regulators of the proliferation. So the inhibitor is working opposite. So inhibition of this proteins allows the proliferation, so it's speeding it up. So it's just the opposite loop.
Are you mean GSK?
Yes.
Can be promote the proliferation?
So GSK, when it's inhibited, it can promote the proliferation. In this case, promote. But usually, actually, in this for this study, it has been not so many things found yet because. Some studies say that the single inhibition of the GSK is not sufficient for the particular type of cells. So that's why they make the combinatory study of the double inhibition of those kinases. So because we know that the GSK itself is mostly in the cancer study, used for cancer study inhibition. So therefore, the for beta cells, for the healthy cells, which are not cancerous, is usually done in combination.
Yeah. This mean is further research about the destruction of or prevent the immune cell to prevent the destruction. Yes.
Well, we don't. In this case, we don't speak about mostly about that because you talk about immune system, right? So we don't do that.
Yeah, yes. Immune cells that can destruction the beta cell in type 1 DM.
Okay? Yes, exactly.
Yes, it is. Do you mean to need further research about this?
Yeah.
This inhibitors?
Yes, it is.
Further research always need.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ibrahim Prithiwan from Medical Laboratory in Erbil Polytechnic University student. Thank you so much for presenting this amazing research. I do have a small question about the this field that you presented, which is there any laboratory tests that can genetically suggest this you know this disease to have some treatment? I mean, if it will be chronic or not?
So actually, you know. Diabetes is for now is a chronic disease. So what we try to do with this approach, we try to not really use the medicines directly for the let's say for the patient. But the ideal thing would be to be able to treat the cell outside and then to make a transplant. So just the whole idea is to. Make the diabetes not a chronic disease with anymore. It normal medications that are usually they require the lifelong treatment. So the classical medications. So you have to take and the resistance is growing. Like for metformin, after a couple of years, the resistance actually is gone. So it must be changed. So it's and the side effects are just. Terrible. So the ideal thing would be to restore the biological function and do not need or at least not to kind of reduce the daily intake of the medicines, which is actually very, very critical. So if it could be done for the long time or a longer time, that would be beneficial.
Thank you so much. And according to your recent research and your experience, is there any genetically treatment for this disease? I mean, can we really genetically treat this disease or not?
Well,
briefly, I mean.
Well, the genetic modifications are always very difficult because you are in the integration in the genes can cause a lot of things. And as you know, for instance, these proteins are, as I mentioned also, they are very, they're involved in multiple processes. So if you try to, let's say, knock down this completely, the gene, you can affect it with different things and you can cause something else. But of course the genetic approach, it has been tried also to reduce the protein level, but that also has some compensation effect later. So it is being done and it's been tried, but not by us. But I don't know about genetic kind of treatment yet.
And thank you so much again.
Okay.
Any final thoughts or questions? I can't see any hands.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you. It's crazy.
Thank you for the interesting workshop. I think it's time now for closing ceremony or very soon. So I think we're waiting for Zora Maysoon. Any updates on the ceremony? Or people will have a coffee break or what? خلصنا. So, شو وقت يسوي؟ Okay. I think we're just waiting for the few minutes. I think some other presenters are finishing in other lecture halls. So we will be done shortly. They will join us shortly for the closing ceremony.
صوت او هبا اشتري او هبا اشتري ها بابا يقدر صوت كو صوت ارو تيست
الو تيست الو يك دو سي الو الو تيست الو يك دو سي تار بين دا پاس دا شازا دا تسلم لایف لسه وای رګر بی ودمه که خسان ورو ګاګا
Have your attention, please. I just want to make sure for the certificate, some of the names, I'm not really sure if they are here. Professor Dr. Nadia Mahmoud. Okay. Professor Dr. Hawin. Dr. Abu Bakr Abdullah. Perfect. Dr. Chiman Saad. Dr. Abdul Karim Karim. Dr. Mohammed Naomi. Dr. Mohammed Mirza. Dr. Nadia Mahmoud. Dr. Mohammed Sharif. Ms. Zainab Yassin. Thank you very much.
باش بنرانی عزیز تا تلوی گراین ولاتن لدومین روزی چوارمین کنفرانسی نیو دولتی زنکو جهان بوزان سکانی تندرستی و هروها بشی بیولوژی زور سپاس کتا استا لگل من بونا ل بینری کردنی ایوه ل چوارمین کنفرانسی نیو دولتی زنکو جهان که بچه هودری برای سعر محمد قادر وزیر خویندنی بالا توجی نوی زنستی هرمی کردستان هم کنفرانس برای و چوه و تا استاش برداومه که پاش چند خوله که کیتر مراسمی کتای هنم با کنفرانس برای و دا چید لزنکو جهان هولی رو لحول کنفرانسی زنکو جهان هولی رو.
أهلا بكم مشاهدين الكرام، رجعنا لكم باليوم الثاني من المؤتمر الدولي الرابع اللي نظمته جامعة جيهان للعلوم الحياة والعلوم الصحية برعاية الأستاذ آرام محمد قادر وزير التعليم العالي والبحث العلمي في إقليم كردستان.
والله بنيراني عزيز بو بيرينانا أو روجي دوما لو كونفرنسي تشوارمي بو بشكاني بيولوجي وارواح زانسة تندروسيا كان حتى أو روج برداوم حتى استاج برداوم باشان خلقي كيتر دواي توابوني همو أو بتوجيناني كلنان توجيران وبيشكش ذكر لهمو او هولانه کله لازانکو جان هولیر هن که امرو لروش دوما لزور هولیتر لنا حرمی زانکو جان هولیر او توجنانه پیشکش کران له هولی اکادمیا له هولکان تری هولی وی آی پی و هر وه لیرش له هولی کنفرانس کان و کو جناب تن بینرانی عزیز کو ایوا بینر بون که ام کنفرانس ل بیانی و سعاده و برداوم بو هتا استا و توجران توجنوی خوان پیشکش دکرو هتا استاش برداوم و کو اما جام پاشان خوله کی کیتر مراسمی کو تاینا بم کنفرانس دکریتن و با بینانه دمه با بینرانی عزیز راب گینم که لم کنفرانس ده 82 توی جینوا آرستای لجنه کنفرانس که کرابون لو توی 82 55 جان ورگیراون که له 18 دولاتی جواز و امرو لزنکو جان هولیر دوینه و او رو برداوامو حتی ساعتی که تریش دوانه برداوامید.
مشاهدينا الكرام نحب نذكركم أنه حضر هذا المؤتمر العديد من الباحثين من الدول العربية والأوروبية اللي قدموا بحوث 82 بحث من قبل منهم 55 فقط 19 من خارج العراق و 36 من داخل العراق.
من الآن يزجيجاي دس خوشي براسي كبو ما ويدوروش أم كونفرنس لزان كوي جيان هولير بريوش وبا بجداري كرديني هج دولات لسران سري جيان لولات عربية كان لزان كو كان ياريمي كردسان وعراق وهروها لولاتاني أوروبا وكو ولاتاني أستراليا بجدار بون ولاتي لبريتانيا باش دارمون لزان کوی وسترن لزان کوی اکسفورد اوز جگای خوشحالی دست خوشی براستی ما خوشحالیه ما شنازیه که زان کوی جان هولر سروکاتی زان کوی جان هولر هستا و با کوکرنو او همو زان کوانا 43 زان کو با ماوی دوروش پروفیسور دکتور ماموسای او همو زان کوانا لیره دا لزان کوی جان هولر و بو دمه با بینرانی عزیز بلیم کوا هر لیره لپنزرکی تماشام دا کرد او پروفیسور و دکتورانه کلا درو هاتی نهرمی کردستان و زان کوی جان هولر براستی کدم بینی لکشی هوای زان کوی جان دین و درون و پیاسه ده کنو رسمی ده گرن براسی یعنی دیارو کسرسام و با جوانی و کشو هوای خوشی زنکوی جیان هولین دینا شون شوفی نجوان هذا اليوم الختامي بعد شوية بعد دقائق يمكن راح تصير الحفلة الختامية لهذا المؤتمر. بهاي اليومين شلون شفتي الأجواء شلون كان برأيك؟
والله برأيي المؤتمر كان كلش ناجح وكل زين واستفادينا هواي من المعلومات اللي قدموها الباحثين وكان مؤتمر راقي الصراحة وكلهم قدموا بشكل جيد.
صحيح.
أيوة إن شاء الله.
هلا بتبي نراني عزيز خوشتان دمي بيتان بلم كوا بشي بيولوجيا كلا بشه كان ك بكمية دوين ريل زان كوا كان هاري ميكردسان وعراقة أوش جاي دس خوش ك لتشلسي ولاتا لتشلسي ولاتا مع مستوى بروفيسور دكتور كوبكي ولير ريل زان كوا جيان هولير وهستي ب بیشکش کردینی و توی جینوا لنان توی جره هر بنابانگ و گورکانی جهان کلیر دا پربو بواره بدریتن لزنکو جهان هولیر و زیاتر ارگا خوش کر بیتن با زنکو کانی تیری حریمی کردستان و عراق و با زنکوانی کلیر دا بشدارن با وی اوانیش بتوانن پربو بشه بدن با بواره بدن بشی بیولوژی و هروها بشی زنسته تندرستی کن بینرانی عزیز سروکی بشی مایکرو بیولوژی لزنکو جهان دکتر امینه صباح من لگلا تفضلی دکتر أهلا بيك دكتورة شلونك أخبارك نورتينا
أهلا وسهلا شكرا
دكتورة أهمية هكذا مؤتمر للقسم البيولوجي بحيث هذا القسم قليل أقليم كردستان والعراق بالجامعات
نعم
يعني مدى اهتمامكم يعني شكد استفادت هذا اليوم الثاني ودنا نوصل مثل ما نقول للختامية شنو استفادت
اللي استفادنا من عنده أنه وجود زملاء يقومون بنفس البحوث أو بحوث مقاربة بحيث حسب قبل ما أجي لهاي المقابلة عقدنا اتفاقية مع بعض الزملاء أنه نسوي بحوث مشتركة جزء منها يصير هنا جزء منها يصير بالسويد بالأمريكا بإنجلترا وإحنا حاليا يعني أنا شخصيا عندي بحث مع شخص بإنجلترا سوينا وهسه نشر بهذا المؤتمر فهي هاي الفكرة لأنه فكرة مني فكرة منك راح نصير فكرتين اللي هو هذا العلم هكذا لازم احنا ويشير لازم اكو شيرنج للمعلومات فهذا حقيقة اللي احنا استفادينا منه اكثر شيء بهذا المؤتمر اضافة طبعا انه تعرفنا على ناس من جامعات
صح
اخرى
صح 18 دولة مو سهلة
اكيد
تجمعهم كلياتهم في جامعة واحدة
اكيد الحمد لله
43 جامعة
43 جامعة بالضبط
زين ست شلون تشوفين هذا المؤتمر شلون يأثر على المجتمع يعني شلون يطور المجتمع شنو
المجتمع راح يتطور لما أني أشوف ناس راح أشوف طرق التعامل طريقة الكلام طريقة تفكير هذا الشخص احنا لازم نتقبل الاختلاف تقبل الاختلاف وخلينا نقول نتعلم الصحيح هو هذا التطور اللي يصير
ست كقسم البيولوجي بجامعة جهان ايش كم بحث انتم قدمتوا بهذا المؤتمر
19 بحث قدمنا
19 بحث
نعم
من 55
نعم
اللجنة اللي وافقت على البحوث كانت مختلطة من بين الجامعات لو بس
من جامعات محلية ودولية يعني بس يعني خلينا نقول المقيمين البحوث احنا نسميها دبل بلايند لا الباحث يعرف منه دا يقيمه ولا المقيم يعرف منه الباحث فصارت ان ما حد يعرف الاخر فالتقييم صار علمي بحت لا غير
يعني هذا بصراحه انا انبهرت يعني من 43 جامعة ومن 50 بحث.
نعم.
19 بحث. نعم. من جامعة جهان. نعم. من دكاترة.
احنا الاتجاه مال اقسامنا بجامعة جهان انه التعاون ايضا بين الاساتذة وليس فقط مع باقي الجامعات.
بس اريد اسال انه شنو التطور اللي شفتيه من المؤتمر العام وهاي السنة؟
التطور اللي أول تطور لاحظناه هو عدد البحوث اللي ازداد في هذا المؤتمر مقارنة بالمؤتمرات السابقة، عدد الدول وعدد الأشخاص الراغبين في القدوم إلى جامعة جهان. مع العلم أكو دول لأسباب شخصية ما قدروا يوصلونا وإلا العدد كان أكثر.
هذه البحوث سوف تقدموها للطلاب كاستفادة
منها؟ أعطيكم معلومة أخرى في هذا المؤتمر وبكل فخر، 4 مجاميع من طلاب المرحلة الرابعة وبإشراف طبعا الأساتذة تم نشر بحوثهم في هذا المؤتمر.
يعني من الطلاب؟
من طلاب مرحلة رابعة.
نقول ما شاء الله.
نقول عاشيكم. تدرسي ما شاء الله.
الحمد لله.
يعني احنا يعني بصراحة آسف سيدة على المقاطعة، من 43 جامعة يكون موافقة على بحوث الطلاب هذا؟
الحمد لله فخر. احنا نفتخر بهم، هذولي أولادنا وهذولي قادة المستقبل.
شكرا جزيلا ست موافقة إن شاء الله.
عاشتي. شكرا جزيلا.
شكرا جزيلا. بلا بینرانی عزیز زور سپاس با دکتر امینه صباح سروکی بشی مایکروبیولوژی لزانکوی جهان هولیر. زور سپاس.
Good afternoon dear researchers and academics. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome you again and to thank you all for participation and attendance in the 4th International Conference on Biological and Health Sciences, which was held at Jihan University, Erbil. Let me announce you the start of the closing session of this conference. I humbly invite Dr. Amina, the honorable member of the conference scientific committee, to deliver her closing speech.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today, as a member of the Scientific Committee and on behalf of all the members of the Scientific and Organizing Committees, I am privileged and honored to speak before you at the end of the 4th International Conference on Biological and Health Sciences. First, we would like to take the opportunity to express our deep thanks to the Chairman of the Board of Trustees of Jihan Group Universities, Dr. Nozad Yahya Bajgar, for his financial support. Thank you. We would also like to express our deep gratitude to the President of Jihan University and the Chairman of the Conference for his continuous encouragement, support, and being a role model for leadership. On many occasions, one gets the feeling that without that person, maybe we couldn't have made it so good. And I would like to ask you to give me the opportunity to thank one person that really made us feel safe and at home. We had technical support from Dr. Hassan Fahmi Hassan. We wouldn't have made it without you. Thank you. We would also like to thank all the reviewers, session chairmen, keynote speakers, workshop speakers, and any person who lent us a helping hand. Today, biological and health sciences occupy an exceptional position among other sciences, not only for their highest importance in human health, but also for the vast scientific and medical achievements accomplished through research that offer something new every day to the world that improves our life quality. Conferences such as this provide a valuable opportunity for researchers to share their knowledge and experiences. We are sure that we had a fruitful and rewarding exchange, bringing together diverse experiences and practices. We hope that you enjoyed the sessions and will take back to your respective new universities new ideas and inspirations for future collaboration with us. We would therefore like to congratulate all of you on such a successful event. The commitment was evident and has been so clearly demonstrated by the presence and active engagement of all of you. We are truly impressed. We all know that much more important work remains to be done to meet the challenges of diseases, to address issues in health, to prevent and treat diseases. And through the conferences, it was clear how many researchers were working hard to make sure that we all live a healthy and disease-free life. In fact, most of the researchers were addressing important medical, biomedical, microbiological, and biotechnological issues that pose a big burden, particularly drug resistance and issues and alternative therapies. Moreover, the importance of nutrition in health and disease was also addressed. Finally, to all of you who are sitting here, and to those who departed earlier, thank you for being part of Jihan University family for these 2 days. Thank you for being part of the success of this conference. Bringing together the collective experience of everyone here truly shows that our healthcare quality and working for a safe future is inevitable. Hope to see you all in future scientific events and through collaborative scientific researches. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, dear Dr. Amina. The next dignitary to honor us with his presence is Professor Dr. Amjad Sabar Dehlawi to deliver his closing speech. Please.
بنای خوای گورو مهربان لکوتای دو روجی پر لا چالاکی زانسی بو اوی سودی بگینا حریم کردستان و زانست خوازان و قطابیان و فرخوازانی او حریما امیو سپاسی که بی پایان سرطا بو همو او برادرانه که لدر و عراق و تشریفیان هینا بو زانکو جیهان و هروا اوانی تریش که لزانکو کانی عراق و زانکو کانی حریم کردستان و تشریفیان هینا شرفمند بون با آمده مونتان لزانکوی جیهان بو او چالکی باشانه بو اوی ولاته کمان بزانست دولمان بگیم. سپاسی بی پایان بو لجنه آمده کاری، لجنه زانستی، لجنکانی ترک همه هنگ بون لکار جیری و میدیا و لآیتی که حولی که زوریان ده لماوی 6 مانگا بو انجام دانی ام کنفرانس که براسی جگای فخر و شانازیه بو منو بو همو کارمدانی زنکوی جیهان. لویش گرنگتر که جماره بشداربوان لدرور عراق زور زور باش بو که جماریان لسیانزه 14 ولاد بو لچن زنکوی چی بناو بانگ. لویش گرنگتر دو ورکشوپی گرنگ هبو که استا که کیسی او ساته که وایزر او نخوشی شکر او اوشتانه که زور گرنگ بو نکتن هبو اوانی صاحبی پسپوری بیولوژین و یا زنست پزشکی کن بلکو بو همو هاولاتیه. سپاس بو همو تان دیسان بخیر هاتن بسر چاو. اسمحوا لي أن باسمي وباسم رئاسة جامعة جيهان ومجلس جامعة وجميع منتسبي جامعة أن أعبر عن شكري وتقديري واعتزازي لمن شرفونا بالحضور في هذا المؤتمر وبالنشاط اللامتناهي طوال يومين خدمة للعلم
خدمة لعلماء كردستان والعراق. شكري وتقديري إلى الذين شرفونا من خارج العراق من جامعات عريقة تحملوا عناء السفر لحضور هذا المؤتمر. وأود أن أشكر زملائي في اللجنة التحضيرية واللجنة العلمية ولجنة تكنولوجيا المعلومات والإعلام والإدارة الذي كان لهم دور بارز وجهود مضنية لعقد هذا المؤتمر طيلة 6 أشهر في تواصل ليل نهار مع الباحثين من خارج العراق ومن داخل العراق للوصول إلى هذه النتائج المشرفة. فعلا أنا أعتز بجهود زملائي في انعقاد هذا المؤتمر. أتمنى منكم ومن كل ضيوف الكرام أن يزورونا ويحضروا معنا في مؤتمرات لاحقة إن شاء الله، متمنيا للجميع التوفيق والسلام عليكم.
Thank you so much. And now, let's enjoy a short video which is about whatever happened in this fabulous Biological and Health Sciences Conference. Let's watch all together. I wish you have enjoyed it. Respected audience, in this closing event, we are going to continue our ceremony by granting the participant certificates. So I ask Dr. Nozat to come to the stage to help us, please. First of all, let me call our respected keynote speakers to the stage. Professor Dr. Christoph Piak, please.
Professor Dr. Hossein Rovan. Associate Professor Dr. Miladur Rahman. Professor Dr. Rezan Abdul Qader. Professor Dr. Abdul Karim Yasin Karim. And now it's time for our session chairman. Assistant Professor Dr. Amina. Professor Dr. Hassanan Tayyar. Professor Dr. Hawin Tawfiq Hassan. Professor Dr. Haja Jamal Hidayat.
Thank you so much, Dr. Noza. Thank you. Let me invite Dr. Amjad to come to the stage, please. And now is the time for the session reporters, who are Dr. Ali Hossein. Dr. Ahmad Salem Mahal. Assistant Professor Dr. Maisara Khalaf. Assistant Professor Mohad Ashraf Docker. Dr. Abdul Salam Matloub. Dr. Anas Al Khoury. Dr. Mustafa Fadil Abbas. And now our workshop presenters, who are Assistant Professor Dr. Anna. Dr. Faraz Al-Ali. Now it's time for the authors. Professor Dr. Mirza Hamza Homadi. Dr.
Dr. Saber Wasman Hamad. Dr. Dobbin. Assistant Professor Dr. Mohsin Al-Ghazi. Assistant Professor Dr. Muhannad Ahmad Ali. Assistant Professor Dr. Qahraman Mam Khidr Khoi. Assistant Lecturer Tanya Salam Saleh. Miss Aya Qaisar Ibrahim. Assistant Professor Dr. Qais Abdullah Nujain. Dr. Haydar Ghazi. Thank you so much, Zakir Amjad. Thank you. And now let me invite Dr. Mason to the stage and continue our authors' names. Dr. Muhammad Chiad Al-Nu'ami is the first author. Dr. Molly Musarrara. Dr. Najah Hadi. Dr. Saif Al-Jabouri. Dr. Suhaila Hamad Sharif. Mr. Ahmad Hassan Muhammad. Assistant Lecturer Mustafa Vanoon Yunus. Assistant Lecturer Noor Lotfi Ali. Assistant Lecturer Noor Sami Omar. Assistant Lecturer Omar Fikrat. Thank you so much. And now let me invite Dr. Abdul Sattar to the stage to grant the certificates. Assistant Lecturer Sarwan Wassam Hamad. Assistant Lecturer Shakir Ogati. Assistant Lecturer Shada Naseh Tawfiq. Assistant Lecturer Sirwan Ahmad Rashid. Assistant Lecturer Triska Viauddin Kamal. Miss Leila Navem Smile. Miss Rayan Sarhang Salahuddin. Mr. Muhammad Sharif Suleiman. Mr. Muhammad Hussein Rauf. Mr. Mustafa Ali Badi. And Ms. Zainab Yasin Muhammad Hassan. If she is available or not. Thank you so much, Dr. Abdelsattar. Okay, dear all, we conclude this conference with a memorial photo shooting ceremony, and we invite Mrs. Professor Amjad Sabir Delawi and Dr. Nozad Yahya Bajgar to come to the filming location, and then I invite you all to take the picture, please. Thank you all. We hope to meet you again in future. Thank you. Thank you.
ماوی دو روز برداوم بولا هولی کنفرانس زان کو جان هولیر او استاله بشمان بینیتان وینه گرتنی با کوملی او همو توی جرانو بشدار بوانی چوارمین کنفرانس نو دولتی زان کو جان هولیر بون.
مشاهدينا الكرام، هاي ختام هذا المؤتمر، المؤتمر مثل ما قلنا المؤتمر الرابع للعلوم، ومثل ما نشوف
صور تصوير بنراني عزيز هلبتا ام كونفرنسا بو ماوي دوروج برداوم بو زور سباسي همو اوانه دكين كماندو بو ماوي شش مانغلا ريخسني چوارمين كونفرنس ني دولت زانكو جهان لبواري بيولوجي وزان ستدري سكن براسي او جگاي دس خوشي خوش حالي وشنازي بو همو کردستان و عراق که زانکو جهان هستا و با کوکرنوی چلوسی زانکو لسرانسری جهان و لحجد ولاتی جاواز و کامرو لزانکو جهان هولیر بون دوینه و او رو با پیشکش کردن و همو او توجینوانه که للاین پروفیسور هر گورکانی جهان و که لزانکو جهان هولیر بون امرو که للاین اوانه و پیشکش کردن و کتایی هات با چوارمین کنفرانسی نیو دولتی زانکو جهان با بواری بیولوژی و زانسته تندرستی کن. دينا شلون شفتي الاجواب هاي اليومين اللي هسه شفت نشوف الصور الاخيره اللي دي ياخذوها الستاف الاكاديمي مال الجامعه والدكاتره البروفيسوريه اللي كانوا مشاركين بهذا المؤتمر؟
والله انا بالبدايه اقول انا كل السعيده لان شاركت بهذا المؤتمر حتى ولو جزء بسيط، يعني قدمنا شيء بس المؤتمر كان كلش حلو كلش ناجح واني فرحانه به لانه كان به ناس كلش راقين ما شاء الله. الحمد لله
انا سعيده براسي جيجايدس خوشي زور سباسي هم وانا دكين كبو ماوي دروج بردام بوم لماندي بونو بي او حسب ماندي بوم كان براسي استافي تلفزيوني جهان ك بهمو استافي خوي وكبو ماوي دروج بردام بولا فشت بخش راس خوي خوي لا پیشکش کردن و پیشاندانی چوارمین کنفرانس نو دولتی زانکو جهان لبواری بیولوژی و زانست تندرستیکان زور سپاس با همو کامیرمانکان با استافی اندازیاریانی دنک بو همو صافی تلویزیون جهان که براستی ماندو بون لماوی دو روش لپیشکش کردن رومال کردنی راستا خوی چوارمین کنفرانسی نیو دولتی زانکوی جهان لبواری بیولوژی و زانست تندرستی کن. زور سپاس بو زانکوی جهان، زور سپاس بو امیداراتی گشتی زانکوی جهان هولیر، زور سپاس بو همو لایک، زور سپاس بو وزارتی خویندنی بالا و توجینوی زانستی برایس آرام محمد قادر وزیر خویندنی بالا و توجینوی زانستی که بچاو دیری او کنفرانسانه لزانکوی جهان لبردامی دانو بردام دبنو دمی پیتان بلیم کوا سبینه کنفرانسی چوارمی نیو دولتی زانکوی جهان با بواری اندازیاری گیاندنو کمپیوتر برای وده چید که اویش به بجداری کمالای کولاتی جهانیه که بجداری کمالای زانکوی جهانه که سبینه با ماوی دو روش اویش بردام دبی لروژی چوارشم و پیشم او کنفرانسش براستی که او پیشانی وده ده که هیزی زانکوی جهان لکوکرنوی زانستو زانین بو هریمی کردستان و عراق لکوکرنوی اهمو تویجی نوانه لو بوارانه که روزانه یعنی سالانه زانکوی جهان برداوم اله پیشکش کردنی خدمت با زانست ده هریمی کردستان و عراق ده.
مشاهدينا بالختام حابة أشكركم متابعينا الكرام وحابة أشكر جامعة جيهان وأشكر دكتور أمجد صابر وأشكر الأستاذ وزير التعليم العلمي العالي والبحث العلمي الدكتور آرام محمد قادر على هاي المؤتمر الحلو، وإن شاء الله من نجاح إلى نجاح وإن شاء الله سنة بعد سنة تطور أكثر وإحنا فخورين جدا.
زور سباس بو همولاك كبو ماوي دروش إيواش لقلمان بينربون بينري أم وكوبلين شالاكيا قوريبن بون أو كونفرانسا قوريبون لزانكو جيهان هولير البته بابونی زانکوی جهان هولیر همیشه زانست و زانی لحری میکردستان و لعراق برو پیشون دا چیتر اما ببلگه وقصه دکن اویل پشمان دبینن لچولوسی زانکوی هری میکردستان و عراق و جهان بجدارن لم کنفرانس دا لحجده ولاتی جاواز دوا بو ماوی دو روش بردوام و لیره دل زانکوی جهان هولیر اوش مای خوش حالو شانازی بو همو کردک که لدو زانست و زانی دگرایتن. زور سپاس بو سرکاتی زانکوی جهان، زور سپاس بو امیدارتی گشتی زانکوی جهان، زور سپاس بو همو اوانه که بو ماوی شش مانگ بردوام بون لخدمت کردن بو سرکوتینی ام کنفرانسا و البته او کنفرانسا زور سرکوتو بو و بشاهدی او همو او میوانانای که امرو بینی مالا نو زانکوی جهان هولیر بهاتو چو با گرتینی وینه یادگاری لزانکوی جهان و هولیر و لشاری هولیر بخوی لحری می کردستان که ایمه بلین زانکوی جهان مامستاکان من پروفیسورکان من اویان سلمان کلناو پنجاو پنج توی جنواد 19 توی جنواد لان زنکوی جهان لان پروفیسورکانی زنکوی جهان هولیر و ورگیر و لام کنفرانس را وشتگی تریش بنام اکو دکتر امین صباح سروکی بشی بیولوژی اما جای بوده که ما قطابی قناقی چوارمی زنکوی جهان هولیر بجدار من با توی جنواد خوان که هشتن از خویندنی زنکوی تاونه کردیو با توی جنواد گوره لگل پروفیسوری هر گوری جهانا کامرو لو کنفرانس دا بجدار بون زور سپاس با همولایک زور سپاس با اختابیانه که بجدارم با توی جنوی خوان زنکوی جهان کردستان آودان زور سپاس با همولایک زور سپاس با هاوکارم دینه که لگل من مندو بو شکر زور سپاس با همولایک زنکوی جهان کردستان آودان حتی ایمو ایوو سبینه دگه نویک لکنفرانسی نیو دولتی زنکوی جهان ایچوارم لبواری اندازیار گندن و کمپیوتر خواتان لگل مع السلامة.